The next section is all about something called the Dropcursor Event. Now, the Dropcursor Event is kind of a nice segue into discussing a lot of the interesting things about the objects inside the display object in ProcessBook. In fact, there's a lot of new things we're introducing here. The Dropcursor Event, as you might guess, is what happens when you drop a trend cursor onto a trend. And I'll show you what that is in just a second. It's kind of a pointer at a specific timestamp. But in order to understand this, we're going to have to look at something called the object called this display. This display represents the current display, whatever that display might be. In this case, this display represents my current open display. That particular display has, like all displays, a symbols collection. Now, the symbols collection is a collection of items of type symbol. Like any good collection, it has a count. And what we're going to do is, as we manipulate the symbols, we're going to be checking to see what type of symbol those are, or that particular symbol is. We're going to be looking for value symbols, because as the cursor is being dropped here, we're going to interrogate the entire symbols collection, find out which symbols are values, and then change the timestamp of that value to match where we drop this cursor using the drop cursor method. Well, before we can talk much more about this, let's just see what the thing is supposed to do. What's supposed to happen is when I click on this cursor, this trend cursor, and then I drop the trend cursor, what I'd like to see is that all the values you see over on the left-hand side, the values that currently say 549, that they're going to change and take the exact same timestamp as this timestamp here. And as you can see, that just happened. As I dropped the cursor, it settled on 223, and that's exactly the same timestamp we see here. Now, that's not the default behavior in ProcessBook. The default behavior is, well, that those things don't change, that they stay at the current time. But we've modified it so that it changes. Now, how can we do that? We need to first find all the objects on here, figure out which ones of these objects are values, take the timestamp that we return from here, and change the end time of these values to match the end time that we get from here. That's basically what we're going to be doing. And the way we do that is with something called the symbols collection. Each of these objects that we see here, all of these objects, these are all symbols. If I add other things, all of these things that we see here, these are all symbols. And we're going to go into VB in a second and learn how to use the symbols collection to rotate through this group of symbols and find just those of the type that we need. Here's the Visual Basic Editor. But before we go into the code, let me just explain something about this symbols collection. See, we're working within this drop cursor event, and when that cursor drops, we want to look for all the symbols we can find and find out what their type is. Well, let's look at the immediate window and let's see if we can learn a little bit about these symbols. See, this display is the name of my current display. It's the workspace I'm working in. If I say let's print this display symbols count, it's going to find all the symbols and count them. Basically, it's going to tell me the count of the collection called symbols in that display. I can look using the item method to find specific items and look at things like their names. For example, the first item in my symbols collection is value. The second item is trend. These are the symbols that we saw in the previous ProcessBook display. What we're doing is we're going to go through that entire set of symbols to try to find individual items like this symbol item 2 and figure out what type it is. When we figure out what type it is, we'll compare that to some constants that come with ProcessBook. And then once we find those that are the right type, in this case it's going to be a value type, then we're going to go ahead and set their timestamp. The drop cursor event you see right here, it returns some interesting stuff that we can use. For example, if I scroll over, you can see it returns something called new time. That's one of the variables that's defined as part of this event. New time is the timestamp at which we drop that cursor. That's what we're going to use later on when we do a set time range. We're going to be using new time. So let's see how we get to the point where we're ready to set time. First of all, we're going to do a for next loop. The for next loop is going to go from 1 to something called this display symbols count. Well, if you remember, the count was 7. There were 7 symbols. We're going to look at each one in rotation here. And each time we look at one, we will look at its type. And we will try to figure out if its type is equal to the type we want, the type being a PB symbol value. Now, that's a value symbol. And that value is a constant that you'll find defined in the process book object library. It's a set of constants that are available to programmers. So instead of putting in the number 10, we can make it more self-documenting by having something like this constant. So if the type is a value type, then we know that what we're working with is a value object. Now, if we do find an object that has the correct type, we take the then portion of the if-then statement. We simply say, let's take that object that was the right type, and we'll execute a set time range. Now, the set time range normally takes two arguments. It takes a start time and an end time. Here's the start time, here's the end time. In the case of the value objects only have really one timestamp. They're a value, they're not a trend. So technically, all we really need to pass is the end time. As you can see, I've passed a null string, an empty string here for the start time, but I am passing the end time. And that's how we accomplish changing the timestamps on all the symbols plus any new symbols I might add by simply dropping the cursor. It's by rotating through the symbols collection. We did that with a for next loop. We did a for next loop through each of the objects in the symbols collection. We can do that same thing using a construct called a for each. And the way we do this is we make use of a variable that's defined as a certain class ID. See, it's this two-step procedure. The first thing we do is we dimension a variable to be an object that is the class of the type of object that we're going to be rotating through. In other words, if we're going to be rotating through a collection of displays, we would dimension this variable as a display. In this case, we're going to be looping through a collection of symbols, so we're going to dimension this variable as a process book symbol type object. Now, once we've got this variable, we can then do a for each construct in which we say for each variable name in the collection of symbols, do a loop. And what will happen is for every one of the objects in that collection, we will repeat that loop only once for each object in the collection. And as we go through that loop, this variable takes a reference to each of the objects in that collection. Let's take a look at what it looks like as we step through the code. Here's the code that's associated with that example. As you can see, I have defined a variable called SMBX to be of type process book object library symbol. Okay. It is defined to be an object that is the same type of object that is in the symbols collection in this display. Now, because this variable is of the same type as this collection, I can do a for each statement. We're saying for each SMBX in that symbols collection. And what this means is we're going to start at the beginning of the symbols collection, and SMBX is going to stand for each symbol in turn as we rotate through that. So if I press F8, as you can see, SMBX has no value now. If I press F8 again, SMBX currently has a value. In fact, I can look at the type of that symbol, and I can look at anything else I'd like to look at for that symbol by drilling down through this variable now. So SMBX stands for the first symbol. We're going to check to see if it is a value. It's a pi value object type. That's a constant in process book. And in this case, it is. If it is a value, then we do the set time range again. In this case, we're setting the time range to be, again, the null string is what we're passing for the start time, and for the end time, we're passing the time that was returned by the drop cursor. If you recall, when I execute a drop cursor returns new time. So I set the first symbol that is a symbol value type symbol. I set its timestamp, and I do this over and over again for each timestamp we find, or for each value we find. Now in this case I have a symbol that is not a value, that's a trend. I recognize that number 10, so we don't set its timestamp. We do this for each one that is a value. And we'll repeat that over and over again until we get through the entire collection of symbols.